is my pleasure to welcome you all on behalf of the many UCI students that are working on or interested in sustainability issues here at UCI. I am Juliana Zanotto. I'm a third-year PhD student here in Planning, Policy, and Design. And it is my pleasure to welcome you all on behalf of the many UCI students that are working on or interested in sustainability issues here at UCI. It is also my pleasure to introduce you to a UCI initiative called Empowering Sustainability. In July 2011, UCI brought together young leaders from 18 countries, including Brazil, Russia, China, Egypt, Israel, and Costa Rica, for a week-long series of seminars, discussions, and inspiring exchange of ideas. This past July, UCI brought together, again, returning members as well as young leaders from six additional countries, Haiti, Cambodia, Chile, Barbados, Nigeria, and Burma. I have here a short video about the program for you.
From the four corners of the world, members of the next generation of leadership of global sustainability on Earth came to UCI. They came for a week-long series of seminars entitled Empowering Sustainability on Earth. The rationale for this initiative is memorialized in lyrics from a 1955 Carnegie Hall concert. In introducing their rendition of When the Saints Go Marching In, the Weavers opened with, "We are traveling in the footsteps of those that have gone before." All of the seminar presenters have indeed traveled in the footsteps and been inspired in their personal lives and in their professional work by those who have gone before. The seminars allowed them to share that experience with the emerging leaders, 70 men and women designated as UCI Sustainability Fellows. There is a later refrain from the Weavers concert which captures the promise of the long-term outcome for each sustainability fellow. In that relevant refrain, they sing, "I am waiting for that morning when the new world is revealed." Now, this new generation of leaders has unparalleled access to the learned and unlearned lessons of the past as they contribute their own vision of a better future for the planet when the new world is revealed.
This Empowering Sustainability group is a very diverse group that brings together activists, practitioners, and academics. Besides the week-long seminars that we have once a year, we're also working on creating connection and establishing a space for dialogue. We're now establishing a website, an electronic magazine, and a peer-reviewed journal here at UCI. So I want to invite Secretary Laird to invite emerging California government leaders of sustainability to join us next year, July 22nd to 26th, here at UCI for our third annual seminar series. To introduce Secretary Laird, I invite Dan Aldrich III, who has contributed to the University of California for the past decades and needs no further introduction. Thank you.
Thank you, Juliana, and thank you to all who are here and to those many people who helped make this afternoon possible. It's amazing to look out at this audience and to have then reflected quickly about that which has just transpired here this afternoon. If there is ever more poignant moment of what the importance of a research university is all about, it's what you've seen here this afternoon. And quite frankly, that message needs to be told time and time again to the people of California, and thank goodness Proposition 30 passed, because if we did not have Proposition 30 passed, we would not have what we have today. So with that, I also am delighted to bring to you today a further example of what the University of California is all about, and you've seen it earlier, and that is my good friend, John Laird. Now, he and I encountered one another at the University of California at Santa Cruz, where I worked at for 18 years. Now, John is a dyed-in-the-wool Democrat. I'm a rhino, that is Republican in name only, okay, in that I am a Rockefeller Republican, more moderate, not dogmatic in a certain sense, but he and I have not necessarily agreed all the time. He in local politics and I have seen differences, but the one thing that's important, and I hope that we can look forward to the future, is that there is trust, there is respect, there is listening, and there is the capacity to collaborate. And John Laird, even though a Democrat, brings that to pass. Now, I am also delighted to say that I am so honored that we had rain today, because we would not have John here if we didn't have rain, because banana slugs need rain. I mean, they slime their way through the forest, and they clean up the detritus. But John is, as a local politician, and I give you, for all of you who are majors in politics or political science, he actually has made his life in politics. And is a political science graduate from UCSC in 1972. That said, he has served the people of the Central Coast and of California in incredible ways. Not only in his effective use and management of the budget when he was head of the state budget activities in the legislature, very critically important, one of the few people to bring actually a balanced budget into play. Thank you, John. Also, he has cared deeply about human justice and social justice. He cares deeply about the environment, and I am honored that he is here with us. And he also exemplifies, quite frankly, the ability, again, to collaborate and to symbolize both the joy or victory of winning, but also the agony of defeat, in that even though the Democrats won wonderfully on Tuesday, for many of you, he is a lifelong Cub fan. So as a Cub fan, he knows the agony of defeat. And it blesses him annually, and that's what keeps him humble, okay? And keeps him focused in terms of listening to the people of California and developing collaborative resolutions of our problems. A legislator who actually brought to pass 82 successful pieces of legislation, and that's no small feat in California. So it's with great pleasure that I bring to you the Honorable Secretary of the State of Natural Resources, Mr. John Laird, for the Alan C. Buck Memorial Lecture.
Thank you very much, Dan. It was a pleasure to be introduced by you. And there's not enough time for a full rebuttal. But Dan and I have known each other for years, and I think it's a tribute to success in politics and the public process when you can try to work things out regardless of your point of view. And given the fact, and I hadn't planned to mention this until Dan did allude to the fact that I'm a lifelong Chicago Cubs fan. And for those of you that are in an environmental protection, it redefines the word resiliency. You really have to do it. And when I was in the state assembly, I was there the year after the Angels won the World Series. And so we had Scotia to the back of the floor to accept the award and the adulation for their victory. And the speaker said to me, you might want to stow your Cubs hat in your desk for when he gets here, because he gave me a heads up. And so he says, I'm really sorry. I know we had to beat a California team to get here. They're really mixed loyalties here in the legislative chambers. But I look across the room and I see this guy in a Chicago Cubs hat. How did you get elected to anything? So there is a history. I know that we're running a little late, and I want to be a real efficient with the time. And I was mentioning to some of the speakers that you came on the edge of making my life miserable, because a lot of the things that were talked about earlier are things that are in my arena. that I have to talk about, and now you actually know something about them, and it might limit the way I would talk about them. But there's two just sort of observations after listening that I thought I would start with that are kind of important. And one is that when I was an undergraduate in Jurassic times, like Dan mentioned, I wrote an undergraduate thesis that got me honors at graduation on the history of water development in California. And the interesting thing was is that when I did it and really got into it and didn't understand it was helping me make a career choice because I've never been far from water policy in my subsequent career, I was a person that tended to be environmental. I was from the coast, and water policy in the state at the time and for the decades before had been driven by the agricultural interests in the Central Valley and the urban interests in Southern California. And I thought that was something I would never penetrate or never be involved in. And so I went from a UC undergraduate thesis to being the person in charge of water policy in California. And so it is a message to all of you that that is something that could be in your future on anything you're working on, and you need to envision it because you could be driving policy at some point on the very research topics you're doing. And the second thing is that I had the pleasure the year before I was appointed resources secretary to teach a class at my alma mater at UC Santa Cruz. I taught a class for seniors in environmental policy, ironically state environmental policy. And when I was preparing the syllabus, the head of the department said to me, you're going to have one particular challenge. And that challenge is the students will believe that you cannot, that the system is so broken and so convoluted and so dominated by special interests that there's no way they will believe they could actually, through the public process, impact public policy. And so I took that as my charge, is to really talk to them about some of the things that you heard about here. I had two classes on marine life protection, to let them know that, in fact, there were really major public policy things going on where people had impacted the process and made a fundamental difference. And I sort of wanted to start there for a second because, as Dan mentioned, I had 82 bills signed into law in my 6 years in the State Assembly, and a plurality of them were in the resources arena. And I really felt from a long career where I was around resources and that I truly understood the major issues facing resources in California. And in becoming resources secretary, I found it, A, that it wasn't totally true, but that we are doing a lot of things in California that people aren't talking about as much, that there is a fundamental change in people's view about sustainability and how resources are managed in California. It's just that with what you saw in some of these talks, we have so far to go to catch up, and we have so far we have to go past that. The real measure is whether or not we're being effective against that. And just to talk about some of them, because it was just 10 or 20 years ago when if you had said that a timber company in California would operate on a sustainable basis and believe that doing a habitat conservation plan was a cost of doing business, you'd have been laughed out of almost any room. And yet, that is starting to move into the timber industry, whether it's the Humboldt Redwoods or Mendocino Redwoods or other companies around. There's still plenty that are of the old ethic, but it's a change. It's a change that's going on in California right now. And I was very surprised to find out that a substantial number of rice farmers in the Sacramento Valley view themselves as much as wetlands managers these days and are in fact getting wetlands conservation easements on their farms. And what they're doing up there is the difference between being able to sustain 3 million Canadian geese flying through a year and 7 million. That is a fundamental change that's going on, and it's sort of a change in view of the people that are most involved. Michael talked to you about the marine protected areas, and California is really out front in what that is, and that has been a change that came rather quickly, because to be specific about what he was telling you, the Marine Life Protection Act was enacted in 1998, and that first designation in the South Central Coast was in 2007. And so there were a series of false starts and inability to move before private philanthropy and public policy really pushed to designate these systems. And it's interesting, because when I was in the legislature, I was exasperated by the fact that it wasn't moving. And so I introduced a stopgap bill to basically co-manage fisheries to try to hold them as best we could until there was the designation. And a lot of the advocates referred to it as a marine protection light derisively. But that just shows how fast that has come on, that designation process. And with energy efficiency, interestingly, it was Governor Brown in his first iteration that really worked to beef up the Energy Commission, to do building standards, such that it's a very old number, but Californians have saved the equivalent of $60 billion in energy costs just because buildings, appliances, other things are more efficient. And we're moving right now into the next generation in many different ways. The latest building standards upgrade that was adopted last year is expected to reduce by 26% more energy consumption in those buildings over the time of those regulations. So there is real change coming there. And when I went into the water, went into the legislature, I became the point person for water conservation. And 10 years ago, when I went into the legislature, the general view on water conservation was something that was advocated by enviros who couldn't stand dams or anything else in water supply, and that was something they could be for in water policy without having to be vulnerable for not supporting other things. And I think it has truly morphed to where now there is a general acceptance that water conservation is an integral part of any water future. Not the only part, but an integral part. And for people in Southern California, it is true in one of those things about where we've made progress, that in the last 25 years, the area served generally by the Metropolitan Water District has grown by 3 million people on exactly the same amount of water. That growth has been accommodated by being efficient and recycling and doing things, you know, to save water. And then AB 32, which I was very proud to be involved with its enactment, has changed the dynamic about emissions in California and what we're doing. It has just completely changed it. And people from around the world are looking at what California has done to see if we're going to be successful in its implementation, to see if others can take the lead. We are really out front in the United States on that. And when you look at that, and you look at the fuel efficiency standards that the Obama administration ended up adopting nationally after the Bush administration undermined and tried to get repealed in California, we have made incredible progress. And I think that one of the keys is right now in resources management, we're trying to, as best you can, operate collaboratively. If you're going to enact something like AB 32, you do your best to make it collaborative. But if in the end you can't do it that way, you do your best to push it across and then hope to collaborate on how you implement it and move it. For example, on marine protection, when Michael was talking about that North Coast designation, when I walked in the door, my very first full day as secretary, I got call from legislators that said the tribes in Mendocino, Humboldt, and Del Norte, and there's 28 federally recognized tribes, have been left out of the process. We would like to introduce bills that do a legislative statutory exemption or deal with them. And the tribes were standing with the recreational fishermen in opposition to the designation of marine protected areas. And so I made a deal, since I know the legislators, it's like, I know that you have to introduce these bills, but it's months before they can be heard, before they would be amended to get near final form. I'll make you a deal. Will you give me 4 months to try to do negotiations and try to do a negotiated settlement? And if I can reach it, move your bills aside. And it took me 4 months. The first 2 months it blew up. And it's pretty hard when you're facing people whose argument is, for thousands of years we fished sustainably off the coast of California, and then you Europeans arrived, overfished, the populations have crashed, and now we are the ones that are supposed to pay the price and not be able to fish after our centuries of sustainable fishery. So I worked out a deal, and the hardest part was finding out a way to do it appropriately in the law, where in the conservation areas, if they can demonstrate a historic take, that they can do that take within the conservation areas. And that has calmed things down. That last designation was approved with more support than it has been, and a very quiet than the other designations, and the tribes have moved in support of marine protection. And that is the kind of collaboration you try to do to problem solve in the resources management to move ahead and meet your overall goals. In Lake Tahoe, last year the Nevada legislature passed a bill that the governor signed that said, we'll pull out of the compact with California for Lake Clarity to preserve the water quality in Lake Tahoe if you don't do these four things. And it was an ultimatum to California, and some things in the ultimatum were really unacceptable to us. And so I engaged the Resources Secretary of Nevada, and we have not had an update to the Tahoe General Plan in 25 years. It keeps blowing up. It's part of the problem. So if you apply for a permit, because of all the things you have to do, it could take years, 3 years, to get a permit to build something in the Tahoe Basin. And it's all about sedimentation going into the lake relating to overall lake quality. So after 4 months of 5 8-hour long negotiating sessions where we brought in a business person from each side of the state line, a Tahoe board member, a local government official, and an enviro, and the two resources secretaries, we hammered out an agreement that is leading to the first general plan update in 25 years that will not weaken the standards, will move toward Lake Clarity, but will make the process work a little better. Both sides have signed off on it. That's about to be approved, and we will save the compact with Nevada on Lake Tahoe. And we're also, there was the maps about, and discussion about desert renewables. And one of the largest places for wind and for solar is the California desert. But it is also a place of some very unique habitats for different species. And so the question is how can we site renewables and protect the species? And we are trying to do a habitat protection plan, conservation plan, in conjunction with the federal government, local governments, environmental NGOs, a broad range of stakeholders, and normally it takes 15 years. We have targeted 4 years so that we can move ahead on the renewables. And I like to tell the story that I'd been secretary about 3 weeks. I was keynoting an environmental conference in Sacramento. It was the first one that I really stepped out on after being appointed. And somebody comes up afterwards and says, I work on renewable energy in the desert. I'm on the environmental side. And so I was sort of quizzical. I said, well, which side is that? And it turns out he was somebody that worked to protect the habitat. And I had to say to him, you don't think with our world's climate collapsing that trying to move to 33% renewable energy in California in the portfolio by 2020 is the environmental side? And he sort of finally said, okay, I'm on the habitat conservation side. But that is exactly what we have to do if we're going to be successful, is engage both things, make sure that we honor both values, and that we do our best that they're not pitted against each other, as hard as it is, and to try to work it out in a collaborative manner. And we also, you may have read that the Fish and Game Department on January 1st will become the Fish and Wildlife Department due to legislation. And we had a year-long process on looking at the current Fish and Game Department and asking how could we improve it, how could we redirect it, because there is this change in California where when we were populated much less, when there was much more rural land, there were hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people that fished and hunted and got permits, and that number has constantly dropped, while there are millions and millions of more people in urban areas. And as a result, the Fish and Game Department right now has more scientists than it has fish and game wardens, because it is dedicated more to habitat and species protection than regulating hunting and fishing, even though that's a very important part of its mission. And these two values have been colliding. And so we had a long process, and believe me, when you have 51 stakeholders in a process, it is, and that's after everybody applied and we winnowed it down substantially. We worked through and came to an agreement on focusing on science, on how there would be operations of the department, and these recommendations were embodied in two bills that were signed into law, and the name change was part of it. And it's reflecting, in many ways, it's a validation of where we are now rather than moving us to a new place, but it really took the operations and the department to try to move to that and recognize that we are more science-based in fish and game. But the challenges that we face are big, and you heard about some of them. The 33% renewable portfolio by 2020 is a big challenge, and we're looking at bioenergy, we're looking at wind and solar, how do we deal in different ways with thermal, and how do we empower this? Are there ways that we provide incentives and then maybe market forces can take over? How do we do this? And so we have been engaged, and the governor is incredibly committed to that. That is one of the things. He even had a conference on extreme events, weather stream events last December, with people from all over the world to try to focus on this and let people learn and see about it in a much broader way. And it was interesting because in the opening seminar, when he was there with a Nobel Prize winner and other people talking about climate change, the New York Times reporter that was moderating it turned to the governor and in one of the first questions says, well, you can either lower emissions or you can adapt. Which are you going to do? And it was one of those things where you had to say, sorry, it's not a choice. Those are not two different options. And one of the biggest challenges is because the resources agency is charged with adaptation. And Al Gore did a great job for the nation in highlighting emissions and how individual actions were tied to them, what the impacts were, putting that in front of people. But we have not had a similar education on adaptation. And it's interesting because when I was in the legislature, I thought, nobody's doing anything on sea level rise. This is crazy. And so I introduced in a session, that's about 6 or 7 years ago, the only bill in that session on sea level rise. And my goal was in coastal jurisdictions to get people to incorporate planning to adapt to sea level rise as part of their local general plans. And I got hoisted on this petard in the state Senate where half the stakeholders said, we won't support your bill unless you set an absolute baseline to measure for sea level rise. And the other half said, if you set a baseline, we will oppose your bill. And I was stuck. And so now I'm the chair of the Ocean Protection Council. And the Ocean Science Trust, scientists from up and down the coast, did elaborate work that was released on sea level rise in California. And it basically said what other surveys have been close to, 14 inches by 2050, 55 inches by 2100. It's been 7 inches in the last 100 years. And the significant thing was, is here it is, it's a year ago May, we have this coming to us at the Ocean Protection Council, and if it had been in place when I was doing my bill, it would have resolved the issue. We'd have been talking about how to deal with it, not where to start. And so we convene at 9 o'clock, well, 8 o'clock, the tsunami from Japan hits the California coast. It was unbelievable, coincidence. And it made the point that it's, I always use the analogy, it's not just a bathtub filling up, it's the two-year-old cannonballing into the bathtub. It's the extreme event, and that's exactly what happened that day. And the two places that were hardest hit were Crescent City, which was hit in the 1964 tsunami out of the Alaskan earthquake, and the Santa Cruz Harbor. And it was at low tide before the sea level rise, measures have happened. And so that is what we're looking at. It's been interesting, the discussion that's been had about it because of this extreme event of Sandy 10 days ago. And that happened at high tide during a full moon, and what the difference was. And that is exactly what we have to plan for with a public that is not awake on this yet. And if you look at the airports of California, I don't know about the one I'm going to fly out of in an hour and a half, but San Francisco, San Jose, Oakland, even I think LAX, if you look at where they are in relation to this, it is not at a good location. They will be underwater. And even if you have big berms, extreme event will make that a lake when it happens. And we saw last week, that's what happened with LaGuardia, that's what happened with Newark, that's what happened with JFK. And so that just is illustrative. That will happen to Battery Park, anything that is near those kind of locations, and we have to be ready. And we have to, and if you're a former local official, where you have a sewage disposal plant that is at the current sea level, gravity flow, some of it coming sideways, same with the water distribution system, it just messes with every urban infrastructure in ways that we haven't started to deal with, and a lot of those projects are built for a 50 or 75 year life, so we are building them for the time that there will be this impact. And of course, and the Salton Sea, I could go on for a bit about that came up earlier, but basically there's an agreement that puts water into the Salton Sea to help against the receding lake line until 2017. And when that water stops coming, it will go down unless one of two things happens. There's an alternate source of water, which seems almost problematic given the water needs for the region that have to be met in other ways, or billions of dollars materialize, and if you read the newspapers at the federal and the state level, where there's a fiscal cliff we averted in the state on Tuesday, there's a fiscal cliff we have to avert at the federal government in about 6 weeks. That's just not going to materialize. So what do we do? And what this agreement really did is buy us the time to decide what the next steps are. And there has to, and there are big habitat issues, habitat protection issues, how do you do ponds, how do you do different things along the line there. That is a big challenge. And also the state's program to protect ag land from urban development has not been funded by the legislature or signed by the governor the last 3 years, and we are on the edge of that being going away. And we've only been saved by the fact that the housing market has had a downturn. But we have to design something that takes the economic pressure off of converting prime ag land to urban uses, and that is a challenge for us going forward. We also have this minor issue of state parks and how we're going to fund them over time. And it's, you don't know how awkward it is for me. When I was budget chair, I proposed the vehicle license fee increase to support state parks and let everybody with the California plate get in free. I can't get two-thirds in the legislature. It goes to the ballot. This major economic meltdown happens before people can vote on it. They turn it down, and I'm appointed to close state parks, which I had worked really hard to prevent. And I went out with a whole host of partners and raised money, and then $20 million of general fund was found in a fund, which destroyed the credibility, and yet, and the legislature has now appropriated that to match donations for parks, but we run the risk of being right back where we started again if we don't hold those partners in and we don't figure out a way to sustainably support state parks over time. And Prop 30, $5.5 billion of the $6 billion in Prop 30 really supported education. It's what everybody was clapping about a while ago. But we also had trigger cuts for CAL FIRE and forest protection, for marine protection and fish and game wardens, for lifeguards and park rangers. So the passage of that it means that we don't have to go in and do those additional cuts, and I am incredibly grateful for that. And then there is the mother of all resources issues, which is the delta and water supply in California. And just for the uninitiated, the Sacramento River flows into the delta from the north, San Joaquin from the south, the McCollumy and other rivers from the east. It flows into the San Francisco Bay. It's an estuary where there's a gradient of salt that can come back in. And at the time that Europeans arrived in California, there were over 500,000 acres of wetlands in the delta. Today, there are 31,000 acres of wetlands in California, and that has fundamentally contributed to the collapse of many fish species that are there. And so there's this constant fight, because in the last 6 years, the average exports from the delta of water for water supply has been 5 million acre feet a year. Yet the project that was built in the 60s and the 70s has pumps at the south of the delta without real fish screens. And so when the pumps operate at a certain level, it reverses flows of streams there. It sucks in salt. Baby fish don't do well in that system. And the water at the south end of the delta is of the worst water quality. And yet anybody that is involved with an environmental NGO wants to make sure that fish are protected and that 470,000 acres of wetlands that was converted is almost entirely converted to farmland. And so the farmers in the delta believe that any habitat restoration is aimed right at them. And I, along with many people before me, have been dropped into this intractable situation with the delta crashing. And if nothing is done over the next 20 or 30 years, the amount of exports will just continually drop without any necessary guarantee of restoration of habitat. And when the major earthquake happens, whether it's 10 years or 50 years, there would be such major levee failure in that area that it could, if it's a substantial earthquake, like 1906, the levee failure would cause water to backflow from the bay and drain into the delta. The farm islands, the soil is peat-based, so it doesn't do well when it mixes with water. And if it's salt water that drains into the farmland, that doesn't do well over time. And for anybody that gets water out of the delta, that could be a 3-year interruption of water service. And when the judge turned off the pumps for 10 days, there were ag districts that were virtually going dry 4 years ago or 5 years ago when that happened. And the Schwarzenegger administration, to their credit, worked really hard to try to address this issue, and there was the water compromise in 2009, and it gave us dual co-equal goals that we have to restore the ecosystem in the Delta, and we have to determine how much water can be reliably exported, and we have to do them together. And as I'm fond of saying, everybody in California is firmly committed to one of the two goals. But the elegance is that you can't have the goal you want unless the other goal is satisfied. And so the Schwarzenegger administration initiated the Bay Delta Conservation Plan, which is don't just look at every species in a one-off, look at the entire Delta, the 30 major species that might be endangered, look at it together. What is a plan for a water project and for ecosystem restoration with the whole region together? But they had the artificial deadline of their last day in office, so they were trying to run fast. And the National Academy of Sciences issued a study right when we were coming into office. It said there's no good analysis, there's no good scientific goals. Well, we embraced that study and agreed. And additionally, there was no public process. It was not open. You had to sign what I referred to as a loyalty oath, which said you had to agree to the outcome of the process to participate in the governance of the process. So for Delta counties and environmental NGOs, they thought they had to agree to a peripheral canal in exchange for them participating in the process. And as a result, substantial stakeholders weren't in the process. And various people would get parts of the science and some wouldn't. It wouldn't necessarily be public. So we just pressed the reset button. We ended the loyalty oath. We created 12 stakeholder groups so people of different viewpoints could look at the major issues and talk about them and try to resolve them. We said that everything will be public at the same time, so that we released 10,000 pages of science last February to everyone at exactly the same time in public. And we have developed a path in the Delta that for the first time is science-based. It is basically the 1982 peripheral canal would have moved 21,000 cubic feet per second around the Delta. The proposal in February with the science was 15,000. We have scaled it down to 9,000, said it would be gravity flow for climate change and emissions reasons, and that the initial operations of a project would be set by our success in ecosystem restoration. That in essence, we would spend the next 15 years adding back at least 2,000 acres of wetlands a year. We would work to reestablish the species that are challenged, and we'd sort of set a range around the current level of exports, even though it could go much further either way, but 5.5 million, 4.5 million acre feet. And if we are successful in restoring habitat, you set the exports at the higher level. If we are not successful, you set the exports at the lower level based on a decision tree of scientific goals and objectives. And for the first time, we have a project that might be permitted by the federal fish agencies, and we have a project that the water contractors, including the Metropolitan Water District of Southern California, are open to. So we have a concept we're pursuing and are trying to work out all these issues. And one of the hardest things is there's passion in Northern California and there's not in Southern California. People are not aware here of what that is, and yet it really affects them. And people in the North are very aware, and a lot of people established their narrative about water in 1982 when the peripheral canal was last on the ballot. And the world has changed. The status quo doesn't work for anybody. Fish populations are on the verge of complete collapse. The exports will continue to drop, but not without a guaranteed return in habitat. And we are trying to do them all within the dual goals and bringing the stakeholders together. And it could blow up at any time, but we are marching arm in arm with the federal government. And completely separately of what you think of any of the presidential candidates and the election we just had, is a relief to me we don't have to start that process over. So we will be releasing the Bay Delta Conservation Plan and finalizing it in the next year. We will be doing environmental documents on a project that allows us to vet with the public the issues I've just been raising with you and see if that works. And it's the first time in 30 years that we have the potential of getting somewhere on this. And it's the first time that science is playing a key part of it. So, and one last thing, because I've run out of time, and that is that I know somebody's here from sort of the Orange County group that's working on education with the marine protected areas. And one of the key things is it's not just the kind of research you saw. There are great volunteer activities for people to involve themselves in resources management in California. And in that case, and this is my analysis, as somebody that comes from Santa Cruz, I used to joke with the Republican leader in the assembly when I was there, you don't seem to understand. Back in Santa Cruz, I'm a moderate, because in Sacramento, they just thought I was the most radical member of the state legislature, and I tried to let them know they hadn't begun to know what the truth was. And I think that some of the local governments had been much more challenging in supporting marine protection here, not the way it might be in some other parts of the state. And it led to incredible grassroots organizing at a good level that now has created one of the best education programs in the state. It's when I was here earlier in the year, I said, I have to confess surprise because I did not think Orange County would be the leader in environmental protection on an issue, but it is on the education, and it working really hard so that you can't board a boat without passing a sign that describes the marine protection areas or have access to a brochure that tells you where they are and what the take is. And so there are many ways that rather than waiting or lobbying or doing other things or not just, but the incredible research and the science, there's actual ways you can involve yourself in resource protection that would make a fundamental difference on the ground in a grassroots level. So it has been a pleasure to be here today. I really enjoyed listening to those, and I learned a lot about what's going on here in the research, and I really hope that we can integrate it in what we're doing, and we're doing our best to try to catch up to the resources management deficit that we have in California, do it in a collaborative way, and try to get to some level of sustainability and leave for the next generation something that they would really want. So thank you for having me here, and I look forward to working together.